Welcome to Rajendra Tandon videos. We take up another verse from Amarushatakam, which deals with a real life situation. But before that, some words about Amaru himself. He was a poet, an observer of men and manners. He was a man of the world who had drunk deep the elixir of life, lived by a lover and had seen the lover's life from a close quarter in its various manifestations. He was a poet of great merit. His observations of men and manners, of the beauty of nature, of goings on between lovers, amongst close friends, in the company of the elders or of strangers, was sharp. He had the words to describe delicate and intimate situations. He had the wit to turn actions of the lovers taken to save their skin into poetic compositions and unforgettable paintings. For Amaru, sex is the essence of life. For him, sex is fun. And he's never vulgar. He believes that the mutual sexual pleasure is the strongest bond between a man and a woman. A couple does not need blessings from gods. Their pleasure alone shall keep them together forever and ever. He writes in one of his verses, "You don't need blessings from Hari, Har, Kartikeya or your other gods. The afterglow on her face shall keep you together forever and ever." When writing about a disdained lover or momentary acrimony, Amaru is more of a modern psychiatrist. Better make up than break apart. An ill wind blows nobody any good. In this particular verse, the beloved is hurt, yet she acts differently. She is many times a mugdha, an innocent one, just awakening into the pleasures of love, intoxicated in anticipation, full of unknown fears, yet madly in love. For her, it is the dawn of youth, as colorful as the sunrise in spring. Kamdev has set her as his soft target. She has been angry with him. He writes, "Her faithless lover, she fought with all the expletives that her sakhis had taught her to taunt him with. You are a rogue. You are a cheat. Get out of my sight," she said. But all in a hurry. The unpleasant task being over, when the expletives had been exhausted, she returned as if no ill wind had blown, to her heart's biddings by nature shown. The nature was impelling her towards union, towards enjoyment, not towards acrimony. So she returned as if no ill wind had blown, says Amaru, to make sweet love and moan. That is the reality of life. And Amaru brings us nearer and nearer. She can fight with him, curse him, ask him to get away, disappear from her eyes, yet in the end, union is the ultimate goal, because that alone would give eternal happiness. She can't allow her empty bed to wait for him. Her heart's biddings are to come together, to surrender, to ask him to take her into his arms, not to resist him, because that alone will give her pleasure. The pleasure is common, but at this point of time in this particular verse, Amaru is writing from her stand, her point of view. And why does she want to return to him? Why does she want to forget that he had been faithless to make sweet love and moan? The word moan describes everything. It gives you the reason, the compulsion under which she is working, she is acting. Thank God for that compulsion. And so we end this particular video. Thank you for visiting this and listening to me. We meet again.